Okay, Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to everybody. So today we are going to continue regarding our lecture on real estate marketing REM 312, and today we are going to look at relating towards market segmentation, targeting and also positioning. Okay. So for the first part, for the first introduction is that we need to have key steps in designing a customer driven marketing strategy, and through this we have the segmentation, the targeting, and the positioning in the market itself. And our role as a real estate marketer is that we are needed to assist and the marketers in arranging the company's marketing mix. And we are going to look also an overview relating towards what is the actual market itself. Okay, so market is the set of actual and potential buyers of a product or services, and this is provided by the reference by Kotler et al. In 2009. So several steps in the targeted marketing, we can see that we can differentiate into four types of steps, which is we did the segmentation, and then we did the targeted marketing, and we differentiate the market, and of course afterwards we are going to position our products in the market itself. So for process of market segmentation, the process itself is to subdivide a market into distinct customers who behave the same way or have similar needs. So market segmentation is the process of viewing a heterogeneous market as consisting of a number of smaller and more homogeneous parts called segments, provided by Harrison 2002. And the process begins with the basis of segmentation, whereby it's a product specific factor and it provides higher value by developing marketing mixes that address the specific needs of the selected segment. Okay, so based on the segmentation itself, not only we need to segmentize the market, but we need to differentiate them based on the demographics or even geographics. For the geographic section, okay, so it is for us to divide the market into nations. Different countries like Malaysia, Brunei, Singapore, the United Kingdom or whatsoever. So if we look into the smaller scope of a nation, like in Malaysia itself, we have about 13 states. We have Perak, Perlis, Kelantan, Johor, Pahang and such. So these different states also have their own preferences, especially towards the products offered in real estate. So in Kuala Lumpur, like in Kuala Lumpur, might be the preference is more towards high-rise properties, high-rise condominiums, apartments, because the land there is quite scarce. So as compared to in Kelantan, maybe not as many as demand towards high-rise apartments. But the demand itself is more towards landed properties. Okay, so that is regarding states. For cities, even in the same state, we have different cities with different preferences. Like in Perak, we have in Ipoh, which is more towards the Kinta Valley region, whereby it's more hilly in terrain, with the view of mountains and even the hills. As we compare to the city of Manjung, Perak is more towards coastal area. So the view is more towards the sea and whatsoever. Okay, so even the preferences for people in the same state can be different based on the cities. Okay, and of course is the climate. For Malaysia, I think the climate is not really that different. Maybe just a little bit different on the lowlands or even the highlands. Is like in Cameron Highlands. So maybe that factor of climate can affect their preferences towards geographic segmentation. Okay. So other than that is the density segmentation, whereby we look at the urban the suburban or even the rural areas in the country. And we are also needed to understand the needs, the preferences and the sensitivity of the local people in the area. Okay, so that one is for geographic segmentation. So if we look at demographic segmentation, so demographic is whereby we look at the people living in the particular area, the people, the humans living there. So these people also have differences, like their age, their gender, the income level of the people, the ethnic of the people, the religion. Like in Malaysia, we have a multicultural ethnic and also religion, and the family life cycle, how many family members they have, how many children that they have. So if a person or a parent that have 5 or 6 children, so living in a 2-bedroom apartment might not be something that is appealing to them. So we need to find out. So we need to find out a little bit regarding the demographics of our potential buyers. So in the classification below, the age, the family life cycle, how many children, who is adults, how many children is the who are still in the school, how many children are toddlers or even babies. So we have to find out. In a sense, we have to do or conduct the research. Even if we try to approach them when we try to sell our product, we will try to ask regarding their background. Don't ask them directly how much is your income, but ask them nicely, or how many is your children, what type of house that you are living right now, what type of car that you drive. Well, if you see a Malay person, of course, is already a Muslim. In Malaysia, every Malay is Muslim. So you can already make some assumptions, and educated assumptions, based on their background. Okay, and then we look at the psychographic segmentation, whereby psychographics refer to the internal characteristics of the individual, such as their attitudes, their beliefs, their preferences, the knowledge, even their personality and also interest. And you have to divide the market based on the way that people think. And some of the variables that we can measure but can be quite difficult is towards their own personality, their motives, their lifestyle, the social class. So you have to find out what is this underlying trend, or even the variables. So sometimes we can't see, like personalities. Like nowadays we have already types of jobs that are based towards social media. We have YouTuber, we have social influencers, we have Twitch streamers. So these people, they have their very specialized lifestyle. Nowadays it's not just the traditional influencing through traditional marketing methods. It's more towards this hybrid concept, whereby the adoption of social media is a very powerful thing nowadays. Okay, other than that is behavioral segmentation, whereby the customer's purchasing behavior is a starting point of segmentation. And we can also divide the market into groups based on their responses, their attitude towards this product, the benefit sorts, the user status, the usage rate or brand loyalty. Like a good case study is whereby we look at petrol stations. Even though they offer up similar products, like the RON 95 or RON 97 petrols, but they offer up membership points, they offer up winnings. You can win 100,000 ringgit, you can win 1 million ringgit if you pump at our petrol station. So even though the product is quite similar, but how they approach the customer is quite different. Some of them focuses on the loyalty. Oh, if you pump with us every time, then you can get this etc. Amount of points, then you can redeem, you can redeem to get some candy the shop, or even you can redeem for petrol and everything. So this is also quite similar. So for real estate developers, for brand loyalty, maybe they can offer up you some referral discounts. If you bring your family members to purchase the same property in the same neighborhood, or even if you are purchasing the second or even the third property with the same developer, they can already check the system. Oh, you are already a previous purchaser, so we can give you 5 to 6% discount for this product. So this is an interesting way to entice people to say, oh, we have been rewarded through the products that we have chosen. Okay, so other than that is user segmentation, the non-user, the ex-user, how we are going to attract people who have never used our product, people who have used our product but they have lost confidence, how we are going to attract them. If you can see, like telco providers, so previously we used Maxis or even Hotlink, but we changed to Celcom. How is Maxis going to attract you back to change back the telco provider from Celcom back to Maxis? How they are going to get your confidence again? Okay, the regular user, first time users. So we as customer, people can be seen as loyal, or even rotators, meaning they are very comfort creatures. People can become comfort creatures. They like to go to the same restaurant, they like to go to the same tourist attraction. If you like to go to Langkawi, every year when there's a school holiday, you went to Langkawi. You don't want to go to Tioman, you don't want to go to Perhentian. So as creature of comforts, how we are going to reward people that is loyal, that is keep repeating back, coming back to get our product. Okay, other than that, people are also deal sensitive and also price sensitive. If they can see that's the same product being sold at different hypermarkets, like if you wanted to buy a toothpaste in 99 Speedmart, is RM4.99, but in Econsave is RM5.50. So you are very sensitive with the even the small changes, even though there's only 50 cents of price difference, but you thought, oh, if I purchase 20 or 30 items in the store, then I can already get some 20 or 30 ringgit savings per item. So that's the case. Sometimes as people, we wanted to get the best value for our money, because money, of course, is not something that is infinite. We have a certain amount of money or paycheck that we can get every month, according to our budget and everything. So we put aside one budget. I put the budget to go to the hypermarket is RM200, like a case study or for example, and then I just wanted to get the best amount of items with RM200. So maybe going to Tesco or going to Econsave or even Maidin, it can bring different deals that we can get. Okay, alright, so this is some of the figures or also graphs whereby we we try to segmentize the consumer based on the people who are more cautious traditionals, the aspirers, the progressives. 22% is progressive, and they are the highest income, the most educated, most experienced customers or consumer with most household durable, place priority on family health, and especially concerned with bacteria and water. So this is more towards water product. Okay, and then we have also market targeting. So it is a process of evaluating and comparing the identified groups, then selecting one or more of them to be served. So evaluation of market segments, we can see the current segment size and growth potential, and we need to find out the right size and growth, the opportunity to make the profit, the segment attractiveness, how you are going to fight in a very saturated market. Like right now, a good example is if you are trying to sell boba tea. Everybody is trying to sell boba tea. So when we have the PKP or MCO, movement control order, people cannot go out and buy your boba tea. Only the cream of the crop, the very strong boba tea companies can survive. The smaller or the new starters, they are facing difficulty in the financial area. Okay, so company objectives and resources is compatible with the company's overall goals, capital. We are also needed to select the targeted market strategies, whereby we look at undifferentiated marketing. We target the whole market. We target everybody. Like as I put the example there is using Coke. Everybody must drink or everybody must eat. So one of the basic needs of people is drinking. So therefore, Coke prioritize their marketing to everybody, meaning the old, the younger generation, the adults, they can say, oh, drinking Coca-Cola is okay. Even though some of the health practitioners, they say, oh, we have to reduce the consumption of carbonated water and sugary drinks. But of course, Coca-Cola, they didn't advertise that kind of information. They say, oh, drinking Coca-Cola is an urban thing, it's a trendy thing. Also like drinking Starbucks, it's a very urban thing. So if you are drinking Starbucks, then you can say, oh, I'm very evolved something. Okay, number two is the differentiated marketing, whereby segmented marketing target for two or more segments with different marketing mix and separate offers for each, and aim for higher sales and stronger position, and more towards the cost impact, whereby you don't particularly market towards a very broad audience like Coca-Cola. Maybe you target to the very specific area or people, whereby they position themselves as a niche product. If we compare with Coca-Cola, maybe we compare now with a house boom. Do you know house boom? The drink house boom. It's a very niche drink, and not everybody knows about the drink, but you can get it at 7-Eleven. It's a very niche drink, very specialized drink. Maybe just the very urban or even the hip and trendy can drink the house boom drink. House boom, HOUSBOOM, something like that. Okay. The concentrated marketing and niche marketing by smaller company with one or few competitors, and the company focus their limited resources on serving very niche marketing area that is unimportant or overlooked by larger competitors, like shopping on the internet, the Harley Davidson, or even the car companies like Ferrari or Lamborghini. Not everybody can purchase a Ferrari or Lamborghini. It's a very niche and specific market. Only the millionaires of the world can purchase a Ferrari or Lamborghini. But that's the reason that makes them so special. Because we don't see them every day. Like we are driving on the highway, we don't see everyday cars like Ferrari or Lamborghini passing by. So the most common ones we can see maybe is Prodoa, Myvi, speeding at 150, 160 kilometers, overtaking Velfires, overtaking Mercedes or whatsoever. So that's the most common one. Because if we compare with Myvi, they are an everyday car, focused to everybody, meaning everybody can purchase Myvi. If you are a royalty, or even you are just a ordinary person, you can purchase a Myvi. But purchasing a Lamborghini, a Ferrari, might not be for everybody in Malaysia. Okay. So this is some of the strategies that we can adopt by using segment on mass marketing. We concentrate our strategy. We have multi-segment strategies and whatsoever. Okay. So market positioning is the battle for the customer's mind, and we need to arrange for our product to occupy a clear, distinctive and desirable place relating towards competing products in the mind of the target market. And especially for real estate products, the terms of location is very important to us. If you sell the same product at different location in our country, it might not produce the same result. If you are selling RM500,000 condominium in Subang Jaya and in Bota, it's going to provide different results. Okay. Okay. So having these positioning maps will help the marketers to identify a positioning strategy. And the sum of the positioning strategies is the features. What kind of benefit or attributes that you can get from the product? The price and the quality that you can get. You enjoy maximum privilege with the minimum subscription fee. Of course, like during this MCO period, we are at home, we are watching the televisions. But nowadays, I think most people are already changing from the traditional satellite TV like Astro. You already changed to iFlix. To Hulu, to Amazon Plus, even most popular in Malaysia, the streaming ones is Netflix. You are watching Netflix, watching Big Bang Theory or something like that. So having the best value for the money that we pay. How many of you still purchase physical CDs or DVDs from Speedy Video? Even Speedy Video in Malaysia, they are already closing down because nobody going to purchase physical DVD or Blu-ray anymore. As you compare with, you subscribe Netflix RM55 per month for the 4K definition, you can watch as many movies or dramas in 4K resolution as compared with you spend RM100-150 for a 4K Blu-ray DVD, then you can watch only one movie. So it's not a very good value towards our money. Okay. Usage occasion, product class, dissociation, user, like the term American Express, businessman's passport. But nowadays in the world, American Express is not really being received anywhere. The most received ones is via Visa or even MasterCard. If you get an American Express credit card, might be you better off use it in the UK or even the US. That one is more appropriate. Okay, so competitor, no other company offers so much and the benefit. So how you are going to claim the benefits of a product? The lowest type of claim is the testimony. The lowest testimony, I've used this skincare product, is going to make my skin glow or whatever. Help research or anything to back up the claim. So you should be taking that kind of claims with a pinch of salt. Might be better if you take the one with the result, clinical health results, that one is much better than just weak, very weak testimonies. Okay. Communicating and delivering chosen position, how you are going to design the marketing mix, you work out the tactical details of the positioning strategy and how it takes time. Okay. So this is an important aspect of the marketing positioning. So this is what we call the four P's, whereby we emphasize on these four P's, four P's. So we have the product, we have the price, we have the place, and we also have the promotion. Okay. So regarding the four P's, I think we will discuss it in the next lecture. But this is a very important concept that we will have always to discuss more, especially in real estate marketing. Okay. So I think that's about it for today. We will see you again in the next lecture. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.